Hello, Malty, Minister of Malty Magic. And thank you to Speyside Media. Thank you, Speyside, for introducing, with your malt mention, ralfy review 885. Welcome to the bothy. I'm ralfy. I talk about whiskey in some detail. I don't keep it generalised and flippant and cheery, telling you that every whiskey's a great whiskey and all alcohol's absolutely magnificent and just drink more, because that isn't telling you very much, although it could be entertaining. In this particular channel, ralfy.com, I go into a little bit of detail and occasionally cover some more controversial subjects which need to be discussed, so we're all aware of it. And more of that shortly. I'll be coming to that in a few minutes. In the meantime, I've just finished a series on independent bottlings of Scotch whisky, which, particularly when you've gained a bit of experience with, over several years, with your official bottlings, you might want to explore a little bit further without too much additional expense, depending on what you're buying, of course, and find the singularity of single malt whisky as expressed, often uniquely, by the independent bottlers, particularly for single malts that do not have an official bottling status. But now that I've completed that, we're on to malternatives. And this is where I introduce, review and discuss other spirits from around the world that are not Scotch single malt whisky. And we're kicking off with a very interesting bottle of Pike Creek Canadian whisky, bottled at 45%. I'm sure it says it somewhere. Yeah, 45%, and aged for 21 years, and that is literally 21 years, in wooden casks. From Canada, from Ontario. I've already poured a glass about 45 minutes ago to let it oxidise, to let it open up and let it settle down. This particular bottling is fairly unique, and you're unlikely to find it in Canada, although you can readily find Pike Creek, because this one was commissioned for the Whiskey Exchange, which is the world's largest online liquor retailer based in London. And just for clarity, I am occasionally a customer of the Whiskey Exchange, and I rate their service very highly. I've never had an issue with them. Sometimes some of their bottlings are a little more expensive than you can obtain elsewhere, but that's an occasional situation. I would particularly commend the Whiskey Exchange, the calibre of boxing up for mail delivery of their whiskies. I've never received any boxes better presented in terms of padding and containment and securing of the bottles, so they don't get smashed in transit. So there we go. Another thing I'm going to comment on the Whiskey Exchange is that they have their range of in-house bottlings, bottling exclusives, bottlings which come from the distillers, different distilleries, exclusively for the Whiskey Exchange. And this is a very good example. This is why it's available in the UK, but not in Canada. This is a Pike Creek which has been finished or further matured in an ex-Speyside whiskey cask, Scotch whiskey cask. And what it's done is it's taken the familiar, rounded, homogenised notes of a Canadian whiskey and give it in a little bit of a Scotch whiskey finish. But to get access to that finish, you need to give it time in the glass, and ideally add just a drop of water into it Not too much, by the way, because it will eventually start to go bitter, wood bitter, fresh wood bitter, which isn't really helping it. But hey, it's Canadian whiskey, and I'm recommending it to all you Scotch whiskey drinkers, because there's nothing helps you get your bearings around Scotch than tasting liquors from other countries and getting to understand them. Now, while that's, I'll lift the lid off now, we nose. Wood, complex wood, fresh resinous wood, sawdust, some wood shavings, fresh wood shavings. If you're ever in a wood cutter's workshop and they're using the plane and you get the smell of different woods, not just oak, and they get them together, particularly on a hot day, that's what I'm getting in the nose. There's a little bit of spices in the background, cassis. In other words, poor man's cinnamon. It's not a cinnamon note, it's a soft wood cinnamon note. It's called cassis. Some mild, dry, powdered ginger, and a little bit of aromatics in the background. Sip. Quite intense and cognac-like on the arrival. Very interesting. Then the wood kicks in, wood sours. In the development, they become more assertive as the development continues. I'm getting some roast plantain banana. I'm getting some fig. I'm getting some old dates or vintage dates. So what I'm getting here is something I recognise as flavour notes you would use for a Scotch whisky. But it coming from a different direction. This is not Scotch whisky. It could be Scotch whisky if Scotch whisky had been further matured in Pike Creek Canadian whisky casks. But that's yet to happen. Now, I'm going to add a drop of water. Not a lot, by the way, because when you add too much water to this, it brings out wood bitterness, which I think I mentioned there, sort of diminishes the flavour range and the integrity of the spirit, which is really interesting and really quite flavoursome. I'm going to move on to a message I got from Adrian, maltmate Adrian, who's also a Patreon pal, by the way, who subscribes to me in my Patreon channel called Ralfy. Hi Ralfy. Do you have any Canadian whisky reviews in the pipeline? Question mark. Canada Day is coming up. Cue Canadian flag and smiley face. Here are some suggestions. Now, just before I go to suggestions, we're actually about 5 days after Canada Day. I'm not one of these reviewers that tries to dovetail in reviews to specific national days, but I will put them fairly near, which is why my next review after this is going to be an American bourbon. So, interestingly, I think worth sharing with you from Adrian, who clearly knows his Canadian whiskey, probably being Canadian, that he lists off a number of Canadian whiskies, which I totally agree with, that they're well worth looking out for. So use this as your tick list for Canadian whiskies, some of which are available where you are and some aren't. The best Canadian whiskies are only available in Canada at the moment, in my opinion. And certainly one reason I bought this is when I look at the selection of Canadian whiskies available in the UK, in the British Isles, Canada Club, younger versions, Crown Royal, younger versions, Wiser's, generic bottlings, some old Seagram's. The choice of Canadian whisky is far more restricted in the UK than the choice of Scotch whiskies available in Canada. Here's Adrian's list, and by the way, I'd call it my list as well, because it's very well informed. Pike Creek 21-year-old, 1-year-old Oloroso, Lot 40 cask strength, first and second editions have age statements. So look out for the first and second editions. I tell you what, Canadian whiskey distillers, get some age statements in your bottling. Up the bottling strength to 46%. You will immediately increase your reputation. It shouldn't be the case, and I'm going to say this now, because I don't want to forget it, but see, in the UK, there's this snobbery towards Canadian whiskey because of the 9% or 11%, I think it's 9% rule, that you can add other ingredients into Canadian whiskey up to 9% of content. And they always say, it includes orange juice. This is a disingenuous, unreasonable put down, which is perpetuated for a simple reason, that a law exists in Canada that has no reason to exist and should be discontinued, and is undermining Canadian whiskey's reputation. I'm Ralphie. That's my message. Canadian distillers, campaign, or to your regional, provincial and national government to get that law changed and make it your personal distillery policy not to adhere to that rule, and make it public. It's not just, it's in the US as well as in Europe, is used as an excuse to downsize and try and downgrade the Canadian whiskey's reputation, and it's nonsense. J.P. Weiser's cask strength, 22 and 23 year old, Canadian Rockies, 17, 21 year old, and Canadian Club, 40, 41, 42, 43 year old. Which, by the way, if you're in Canada, these old Canadian clubs are far better value of the money for money than Scotch whiskies age statements of a similar number. If you're looking at any 41, 40, 43, 42 year old Scotch whiskey, you're paying an outrageous premium for them now, one which I refuse to pay, but in Canada they're still relatively accessible price wise, although I don't see that situation lasting much longer. They are, Adrian admits, a little harder to obtain, but well worth looking out for, because they showcase what Canadian whiskey is genuinely capable of in terms of intrinsic quality. There's some fabulous stuff out there which I can't buy and I don't see, because quite rightly Canadians are keeping it for themselves. And I'll come on to one such distillery shortly, and I'm talking about quite a lot of these new distilleries that are cropping up, particularly new Canadian distilleries, young Canadian distilleries who are producing malted barley spirit and not the separate mash bill post-blended style of whiskey. Righty-o, anything else? Yeah. Probably for lower quality than the older whiskies, try, but just, you know, good in their own way. Highwood 95-year-old, Pike Creek 10-year-old, Gibson's Finest 18-year-old, and something from Glenbretton, 10, 14, 19, 21. I'll be back to Glenbretton shortly. Thank you, Adrian. Good, solid Canadian mentions, and endorsed by Ralphie. I was very fortunate to be invited over on two occasions. I was going to put three fingers up on two occasions to Canada to be a guest at whiskey festivals. And I must say, the level of interest, articulate sensibility, and the absolute unconditional friendliness of Canadians was very heartwarming and much appreciated. So there we go. But I don't attend whiskey festivals now, apart from one in Glasgow, because it's just not me. It's just, I just find it terribly awkward when things are kind of showcased around Ralphie. Whiskey festivals are about the whiskey, not about faces and names. It should be all about the whiskey. Just like the forthcoming Belfast Whiskey Week Festival, kicking off in a couple of weeks. Yeah, just a couple of weeks' time. Look out for it, check it up online. Very good whiskey festival. So, We've given this Pike Creek plenty of time with a drop of water. Let's get back to it. Softer, complex wood aromatics on the nose. Some mild, traditional cola. I'm talking real cola, not corporate brand cola. Cola that you taste in real colas or in cola nut extracts from herbal medicinal providers. Raisin. Real musty, slightly resinous, mixed woods. I'm getting woods other than oak going on here. Dry ginger, powdered ginger again. A little bit of allspice. A little touch of clove, old clove, dried clove, diminished intensity clove in the background. And a homogeneous, resinous presence, which is very hard to unravel and unpick. Resinous as in wood resins. Taste. Delightfully zesty. Wood zest. No bitterness in the arrival. The wood is there. Cask wood shavings, wood shavings. But with age, they're not fresh and overly assertive. The 21 years in the cask has really toned things down beautifully to such an extent that you're actually getting a great balance between the grains used and the casks used, so that you don't have too much cask dominance. There's some background dates and figs and soft prune notes and raisin, all these sort of dried fruits put into one, and a certain spiciness kind of interplaying, interwoven in with the grains. Slight cola, red cola, British confectionery. It's a sort of red fruit cola, that's what red cola is. Pineapple, notes of pineapple. Wonderful mouthfeel. The finish is an absolute continuity of the development. It's got some lemon oil in there, some pickled ginger, as in sushi ginger, green ginger that's sort of been slightly sweetened, sweet and sour. A little bit of floral note in the finish. I'm trying to pick out what it is. I think the nearest I get is a slight rose otto. That's as near as I can get. But a very interesting, good quality Canadian whiskey. And I can tell you right now, the price for this in the UK, for the age and the time it's spent in the cask, is offering better value than most Scotch whiskies at a similar age, which charge so much more. Sure, malted barley spirit can be more complex, but it's all about the cask. It's not necessarily the case that it will be. I'd be interested to really see how this behaved if a Canadian Pike Creek separate mash bill whiskey was made involving single malt, malted barley and unmalted barley Canadian whiskey to further extend the variety of flavour contributors. Now that would be really, really interesting. And I'd say the way to start is to import some Scotch whiskey and create some Pike Creek hybrids. There we are, a little bit of bon accord, a little bit of that Caledonian connection, a little bit of that Scottish heritage thing, which is absolutely inextricably woven into the fabric of Canadian society. I'll be coming back to this in Ralfy Review 885 Extras, in which I'll be discussing a Canadian situation in 2021. It is really quite controversial. Very few people are openly talking about it on the internet, but I think it's something we should all be aware of, and I'm going to talk about it. There you go. So let's conclude with a malt. I'm just going to say it's a blended mark, actually. Pike Creek. I'm going to call it blended rather than Canadian whiskey because it's a blend of different grains distilled separately, matured separately, the Canadian style, and then blended on maturation. Now, I don't know for sure if this is the way they actually do it. I haven't done my research. That's the value of just giving an opinion and perspective. The thing is about doing research is you can get mixed messages. You tend to get what a distillery wants you to hear. So I think it's better, rather than doing too much field research, is to focus more on what we're getting out the glass in terms of smell and taste. A wee drop of water certainly helps this. Interesting stuff. Ralfy recommended to Scotch whisky drinkers in the UK. I'm Ralfy. Join me shortly for Ralfy Review 885 Extras, in which I will be talking about the Canadian situation 2021. You're curious now. I know you are.